oxygen machines on the sidewalks. And when a person becomes unable to breathe from the fume-laden atmosphere, he can put in a coin and have a sniff of oxygen. Again, we're told that if jet travel goes on, especially Concorde travel, when so much fuel will be used, we will end by polluting the atmosphere with a blanket of poison all round about it. These are grim facts. And there's one very strange explanation of part of this, a very small part of it, which comes from the fact that we are now so sophisticated socially that the disposal of waste has become more and more of a problem. This comes because we insist more and more on elegant packaging. Elegant packaging is done in plastic, and plastic is practically indestructible. You flung paper or cardboard into the ocean, and the ocean dealt with it, but it can't deal with plastic. There's a curiously contributing cause to this, which is rather illuminating about modern civilization, that nowadays there are so many homes when you can't burn anything. Houses are centrally heated, and there is no fire into which things can be so handily thrown as they used to be. There's still another problem facing Scotland just now. It's the conservation of scenery and the conservation of a way of life. Then there's a real problem here. The conservation of scenery as against the means of oil production. Now the problem is just this, that you can't live in scenery, however beautiful it is. You can't survive in views, however lovely the views are. And there is a way of life to be preserved, but there is no doubt about it, it's an aging way of life. It's a vanishing way of life. And it's a way of life from people who have little or nothing to do and who are wealthy enough to live at ease and luxury in these splendid surroundings. And the trouble is that fewer and fewer people are living in this scenic beauty because there's no work to do. They've got to leave the scenic places to go and look for places to work. And so you've got this conflict, this confrontation, this collision between scenic beauty, a way of life, scenery, and the industrial demands that new processes would make. It has happened again and again. It happened in the railway age. In the railway age, things happened because people wanted to conserve beauties which should never have happened. There were, of course, many proprietors who were glad to see the railway go through their land, some of them almost for nothing. There were other proprietors who charged heavily for letting the railway through their land, but there were a certain small number of proprietors who simply would not allow railways through their lands in order to conserve the beauty. And so you take just one line, the Dumfries to Stranraer line. On the Dumfries to Stranraer line, the New Galloway railway station is 16 miles from New Galloway. And the Gatehouse of Fleet railway station is 6 miles from Gatehouse, simply because landowners would not allow them any nearer. And of course, such railway stations are useless, and Dumfries to Stranraer simply lost their railway line. From the end, it was serving no one. Again, in the case of North Scotland, for instance, Strathbeffer has no railway line for the simple reason that the person who owned the land wouldn't let it at any cost or sell it at any price. And so Strathbeffer had to be removed from the main line at a branch line which has long since closed. So we see conservation, especially selfish conservation, has its problems as well as the destruction of beauty has its problems too. Now we look at world resources in general, and certain things stand out straight away. First, no country is self-sufficient. Every country needs something from some other country. Second, there's a rapidly expanding population. The population of the world will be doubling itself very soon in every 10 years. Thirdly, there is the grim fact that 2 out of every 3 people go to bed hungry every night. And yet we hear about mountains of butter and lakes of wine. And I should think that in spite of all the warnings and in spite of all the grim warnings, it's not really resources which are the problem. The problem is distribution. That the resources are there and will be there for many years, but the problem of distribution is very uneven. Now, I would suggest that in regard to conservation and in regard to the use of world resources, certain things may be said, in particular these two. I think we've got to extend our view in time. And we've got to ask, what is our responsibility to the future? How does it affect generations still unborn? For instance, that happened in Central America when, by bad soil conservation, they produced a dust bowl where nothing will grow. And what we've got to ask ourselves is, how does what we are going to do affect the generations still unborn? Be it in scenery, be it in world resources, be it in whatever it is, we've got to extend our view. And secondly, I think we've got to expand our view. And we've got really to realize that we do live in one world. I wonder if any of you do the kind of thing I find myself very apt to do. I read my newspaper and I open the paper and I see a railway accident, 120 killed. And I read the first line of the paragraph and I find it's in America or South America or somewhere. And I just turn over the page, it's got nothing to do with me. Now I find myself doing this over and over again and I couldn't do a worse thing. I've got to expand my view, everyone has, until we do come to the conception of one world. And in this one world, we've got to realize we are all bound up together in the bundle of life, and there must be deliberate, and if need be, sacrificial help for the undeveloped countries. The curious thing is that here, Christian point of view and the practical point of view and the human point of view all coincide. The Christian point of view is that this is right, that we are living in one world, that we are one body, all people, and that we've got to do everything for the undeveloped countries and those who are poorer than we are. Now this Christian point of view would be backed by the economic point of view. If we do this, the economic point of view will tell you, we open up new markets. This Christian point of view would be upheld by the social point of view. We would raise the level of life. It's an extraordinary thought that there are 700 million people in the world who can't read a word to this day. And if we raise the social level, we raise the general level of the world. And also, if we get a grip of this one world, helping the undeveloped nations, it is a political safeguard as well. Because political unrest and want and poverty are intimately connected with revolution and rebellion and trouble, and political stability and plenty are similarly interconnected. And therefore, for once, practical politics and theoretical Christianity meet. That the idea of one world, where world resources are properly distributed, is not only a Christian point of view, it's an economic point of view, it's a social point of view, and it's a political point of view. So I would say, summing it up, that what we need to cultivate in ourselves and in others is an extended view and an expanded view. And we can do this not only by pressing the Christian point of view, but by pressing the importance of this for what we may call practical politics.
Our subject in this discussion is the subject of stealing. We are at the present moment living in what is probably the most dishonest age that history has ever seen. Tens of millions of pounds are lost every year through pilfering. Stores are now being compelled to install closed-circuit television so that a watch may be kept on the customers. Even in the university bookshop, there are notices that anyone found stealing a book or any other thing will be prosecuted without any choice and without any mercy, because things have become so bad. This pilfering is everywhere. It's in shops, in shipyards and in factories. Wood and tools and electrical fittings are taken. In offices, stamps, phone calls, petty cash are taken. In the railways, in the buses, in the underground, people try to evade the payment of fares. Parked cars are stolen and broken into. Pickpockets on the streets. In clubs, hotels and cloakrooms, care is to be taken that things will not be stolen. And there are armed raids and hold-ups when there is robbery on a big scale. So then it is an extremely dishonest age, and this dishonesty is widely spread. We may classify the people who are guilty of this dishonesty. Firstly, there are those who steal definitely for gain, who steal in order to sell or dispose of the things that they have stolen. Secondly, there are what you can only call human magpies. You see every now and again things in the newspapers about people who have rooms which are crammed with things which they have stolen from shops and from other places. They never seem to dispose of them. They never seem to do anything with them. They just collect them. There are those who are definitely suffering from kleptomania and who steal because they can't help it. There are those who are wealthy people and who have no need to steal at all, and who have often plenty of money in their pockets, and who yet go into shops and steal. There are, and this is perhaps the most serious thing of all, there are those who steal for kicks. In good schools, the best schools in the town, there are often classes in which stealing has to be done for a dare. And if the boy or the girl doesn't steal, then they've got a bad name in the class. And I've actually known of parents who had to go back to the shops with things that their children have stolen. And as I say, this happens in the best of schools, and to steal is a prestige operation. And of course there is the adventurous kind of stealing that presumably all of us have at some time or other done. Robbing the orchard, robbing the apple tree, robbing the pear tree or the fruit bush, as Augustine did when he was a boy, not really to eat the thing at all, but simply for the thrill of stealing. Now that's one side of it, but there are at least two other things to be said in regard to this. In another sense, it's an age of quite staggering honesty. You, for instance, see in London newspapers left completely unattended on the main streets, and you take one and you pay your money, and obviously this wouldn't be done if they were stolen in any quantity. I've gone down the streets of smaller towns during the lunch hour to find the thing still left outside the shop, and obviously safe from any thief. So there is another side to this. There's a side in which in which life in this country is still amazingly honest. And again, it has to be said that we are living not only in an unparalleled age of theft, but we are living in an unparalleled age of temptation. There can never have been any temptation of stealing like the open store nowadays, where things are all laid out in the stores at the counters, and where shop assistants are comparatively few, where you have to take your purchases to a central desk, then the temptation to steal is very vivid and very acute. Now, what's to be done about this? Well, I think we can, in a whole, divide again the punishment into three different kinds of people. For those who steal for gain, who steal to sell or to dispose of the goods again, there can only be one consequence, and that consequence must be punishment, and severe punishment. There are the people who have kleptomania and the human magpies, and they, I think, must have treatment. It's not that they mustn't be punished, but the punishment must be much more curative than it is simply a matter of retribution. And there are the people who steal for kicks. The schoolboys and the schoolgirls and perhaps the older people who steal just because it's a prestige operation to steal. I think what they have to be shown is that stealing in that way is not clever, it's just despicable. And I think probably there should be more publicity for this kind of crime. Because I think that one of the saving things is shame. And if they were really publicised, if their names were publicised, and I think there might be less of this, I would myself have less mercy on these people than is generally shown, because I think that shame is the only cure. I've spoken about the obvious kinds of stealing, and no doubt these will be discussed, but there are just three things which are not quite so obvious. For instance, there's day and daily theft of time, and there's day and daily theft of effort. When we enter into an agreement with an employer to pay us so much wage, we also enter into an engagement to give him so much time and so much effort. And there is in almost every trade and every profession an enormous amount of wasted time, an enormous failure to put one's total effort into the job. And there is one last kind of stealing, the stealing of people's good names and the stealing of people's reputation. This is done by gossip. It's done by the transmitting of stories for which there is no real evidence, and it's done by talking about people without really having any knowledge of what we are talking about. This is not so obvious, and a different kind of stealing, but it is an important kind of stealing, a very important kind of stealing. And I think the whole action, the whole reaction to this business of stealing should be to produce in people not the feeling that it's a thing of prestige to steal, but that it is a shameful thing to steal, a thing that we should never stoop to. The subject of this discussion is the mass media. And by the mass media, we mean newspapers, films, radio, and television. There never was an age when news could be transmitted so quickly and so widely as the age in which we live. When the Roman Empire was at its greatest, a defeat in Parthia might take anything from 6 to 7 weeks to penetrate to Rome. When Alexander the Great was managing his campaigns in India, it would take about 3 months for news of a battle to get back to his home in Macedonia. But nowadays, the thing is known almost as quickly as it happens. Even in the furthest corner of the earth, if there is any event, famine, flood, war, pestilence, the thing is known at once. The transmission of news is very fast indeed. Again, there's never been an opportunity to speak to masses the way there is today. In the old days, people spoke to a few hundred, or at the most a few thousand. If you take the case of Jesus himself, his greatest audience, if you accept the figures of the New Testament, his greatest audience must have been somewhere over 5,000 at the feeding of the 5,000. But nowadays, a man can speak to 500 million at a time when he's linked up in a world of broadcast. So there is this speed of the passage of news, and there is this ease of disseminating news on the widest possible scale. Now, one of the results of this is that the world has become a very much smaller place. A place when India is on our television screen, or when Africa comes in at our front door, so to speak, and there's very much the possibility of one world such as it ever was before. Disaster and all kinds of things, political situations, can be known so easily at first hand in a way that was never possible in any other generation. In the second place, the mass media provide a platform. For instance, they provide a platform when political elections are in the offing, when speeches are made. And it's very valuable that you should see a man speaking as well as read what he said in print, because seeing him will make a difference in your evaluation of what he is saying. And this platform business is a good thing. Again, thirdly, Perhaps one of the greatest things about the mass media, particularly in regard to radio and television, is that they bring into our own home things of a quality that we would never otherwise have seen. We see drama, we see music, we see ballet, we see comedy, we see tragedy, we see sport at our own fireside that probably we would never have otherwise seen at all. If we don't stay near big cities, we would never get a chance to see these things. And if we stayed in big cities, we probably couldn't afford to see them. And yet, by use of the mass media, these things are brought to our fireside. Then fourthly, not only do the mass media bring entertainment to our fireside, they bring knowledge as well. For instance, take the case of the Open University. The Open University depends upon the air and the mass media in distant places where there are no night passes, no chance of getting to the university, in distant places and even in towns where there are housewives who could never take the time off to attend classes properly. The mass media and the Open University give a chance of learning which was never before. Fifthly, the mass media provide a very great platform for religion. In this, we're lucky in this country because we get our time to do our religious broadcasts in this country for nothing. In fact, those who broadcast are paid for doing it. But in the like of America, for instance, in very many cases, the people who broadcast in religion have to pay for the time. The churches don't get the time for nothing. They pay for it, as any other advertiser would do. But in this country, we have this freedom of the air given to religion. And in some sense, this has actually become a substitute for the church. Because it used to be true, and I suppose it still is true, that the Sunday morning service, especially the people's service, something like 10 times as many people listened to that on the air as were in all the churches put together. Of course, there is a difficulty about this. It's never the same hearing a great orchestra sitting in a room all by yourself. It's never the same seeing a football match all by yourself. The crowd is part of the game, and the crowd is part of the performance. And as for religious broadcasting, it isn't the same as church worship at all. For instance, a person during a religious broadcast will have no hesitation in lighting a cigarette. He'll have no hesitation in the middle of a broadcast prayer to get up and look out the window or something like this. In other words, there is something lacking, but still the thing is there. Now, we've spoken about the great advantages the mass media give us, but there are dangers. The first danger is surely this, that as the door is open to the best, so the door is open to the worst. And so you get brought into your house, kind of language you wouldn't really like. You get sometimes a glorification of violence. You get the heroic villain and all this kind of thing. And I think there isn't any doubt that at least some of the prevalent violence comes from seeing violence on television and on the screen. So the worst can come into the house as well as the best through the mass media. And take the case of the films. The films, the pictures, tend to glamorize certain things that shouldn't be glamorized. They tend to glamorize luxury, and they tend to glamorize infidelity. The morality of those who work on the films, those main actresses and actors, is something which is very often to be deplored. And because they are models for the young people to copy, then the young people tend to become the same kind of people as the people they admire, and this is dangerous. Then take the case of newspapers. What we may say about newspapers is just this, just in one sentence. The newspapers tend to report rather what is interesting than what is important. Very, very often, important things get just a line or two in a back page. Well, something which is not really important, which is momentarily sensational, occupies the front page. Leslie Tizard of Cars Lane is one of the great nonconformist preachers in England. And Leslie Tizard died of cancer all too young. And when he was dying, he used to read a lot of newspapers and watch a lot of television and see a lot of films because he hadn't the strength to do anything else. And he said, near the end, he said, "I'm tired of having the front of my mind continuously tickled.
no depth in it, no reality in it. The thing was interesting enough, sensational enough, but the real things were not put on. Now, we've spoken about the dangers of the mass media and of the great blessing that it brings, but there's one supreme danger. And the one supreme danger is the opportunity, or rather the possibility, of deliberate propaganda. During the war, when Goebbels was running Hitler's publicity stuff, his propaganda, Goebbels' principle was that if you repeated a thing often enough, then people would in the end believe it. Now, this is the danger for mass media. The mass media, if the wrong people got their hands on it, could become a terrible propaganda for evil. And that is why there must never be any government control or government monopoly of either newspapers or television or radio. Because they give an opportunity which is extremely dangerous. It's not likely that there will be in this country, because this battle was fought and won in 1926. It was fought and won by the person who did more for broadcasting than any other single person, Sir John Rees. In 1926, there was the general strike. And during the general strike, Rees insisted on giving absolutely unbiased reports of what was happening. Winston Churchill was a member of the government at the time. And Winston Churchill wanted to take over all the mass media, including radio — there was no television in those days — including radio, in order to blast the strikers out of existence. In other words, he wanted to use the radio for government propaganda. And even if conceivably it could be used for correct propaganda, there is always the danger of incorrect propaganda. And I should say that the mass media are like a strong drug. They can be very useful, they can be very harmful, and above all, they need to be used correctly. The subject of our discussion is organ transplants. One of the most spectacular achievements of modern surgery is transplantation. There's transplantation, for instance, of corneal grafts. There has been transplantation of the heart, of kidneys, of lungs. And it may be that we don't realize just how recent this is. The first successful kidney transplant was done in 1954. And it was a transplant of a kidney from one identical twin to another. The next milestone on the way was when a successful transplant was done not between twins, but between people more distantly related. And that happened in 1959. Now, this has become quite a common thing in surgery, but there is quite a lot of doubt about it. First of all, one would want to say this, that there is nothing in theological doctrine or theological theory against it whatsoever. When we die, we are finished with our body. We have no more interest in it. Even if we believe in the resurrection of the body, we do not believe in the resurrection of this lump of flesh with which we die. The resurrection of the body is a phrase which simply came into the creed because Greek happens to have no word for personality. And the resurrection of the body simply means the survival of the individual as an individual. Therefore, what happens to his body once he's dead is of no importance, and certainly of no importance to the man himself. Secondly, there are certain difficulties in practice. And in this country, not in every country, not on the continent in some countries, not in America, but in this country there is a very considerable legal difficulty. Because the strange thing in this country is, under the law, the only thing that you cannot absolutely dispose of is your own body. In the 1961 Living Tissue Act, permission is given for your trustee or your executor to give your body for medical research if you have so willed it,
provided the surviving spouse, if there is a surviving spouse, consents, but only may do so. And if the executor, or the people who are looking after your affairs after you died, said no, even if you had said yes, it can't be changed. And the trouble about this is that you can't argue about this. Because if a kidney is going to be transplanted from one body to another, it needs to be removed from the body of the donor within 40 minutes of death, or irreversible damage has come in. And therefore, when a person dies, you have to act quickly. And you can't go on and investigate whether it's possible to do it or not and consult the executors and all this kind of thing. This is to be done ahead. And perhaps one of the things that should be done straight away is for it to be settled that you can do what you like with your own body. And if you wish to leave it for medical purposes, you can. Now, a third difficulty is, if there's going to be transplants, there's going to be a shortage of what you can only call spare parts. And therefore, you've got to come to some decision. Who gets the spare part? Now, this is a very difficult decision to make. In America, and in some other places, there are committees which decide this. But suppose a kidney is required by two people, and a kidney has become available. Suppose one of the people is a surgeon, and a very famous surgeon, who could save a lot of lives. But suppose the other person is a mother of six young children. Who would you give the kidney to? There is this difficulty, and it is a very serious difficulty indeed. Then, of course, there are the medical difficulties. And the medical difficulties mainly come from the body's instinctive and built-in ability to resist all foreign substances. The real problem is not the technique of surgery. That has been conquered long ago. The real problem is immunology. And this is something which has not yet been mastered. Up until 1970, there were only 15 cases of transplants who had lived for longer than 3 years. Transplanted kidneys who had lived for longer than 3 years. And there is this difficulty to this day. And in addition to that medical difficulty, there is the difficulty that if a hospital goes in for a heart transplant, almost everything else in the hospital stops. And are you really justified in giving up a whole ward, giving up the occupancy of an operating theatre, for this one person, when perhaps a score of people could have been helped to live? But the greatest difficulty is the difficulty of defining what death is. Now, I've taken most of my information about this particular section from this book. It's a CIBA Foundation Blueprint, The Law and Ethics of Transplantation. This book was written 6 or 7 years ago, and I think it's still the best book, the most comprehensive book, on this matter of organ transplantation. Now, as I say, the biggest difficulty is to define just when death has happened. I suppose that most of us would say that death has happened when the heart has stopped beating and when the lungs have stopped all respiration. Yes, but you can keep a man's heart beating and you can keep his lungs pumping long after he is, in any real sense of the word, dead. For instance, you can guillotine a man, cut his head off, and you can still, after he's dead, keep his heart pumping, and his lungs breathing. This can be done. And again, one of the tests of whether a person's dead or not is the application to his brain of the electroencephalogram. Now, some doctors would say that if the electroencephalogram has no reaction after 1 minute, after 5 minutes, after 20 minutes, then you can assume that the man is dead. But this isn't a real test, because there have been cases where the electroencephalogram gave no register at all for several hours, and the person still lived, particularly in cases of barbiturate poisoning. You can, if you like, keep a man alive in a certain sense almost forever. You fix a respirating machine, you fix a heart machine to him, you keep his heart beating and you keep his lungs pumping, and you can in that sense keep him alive even when his brain has stopped having any real life in it whatsoever. Now, this is the real problem. Just what right have you in this particular case? In other words, when would you switch off the machine? Now, I take three cases from this SIBA book, and three cases just to show the kind of problems that arise. A woman was in a hospital, and she had been on artificial means of keeping her breathing and keeping her heart going for some time. The professor of neurology was called in to examine her. She was comatose. She was, of course, unconscious. And when he had examined her, he said that, to all intents and purposes, she was quite literally dead. Well, they kept her going for a little while longer, and then they switched the machine off. When they switched the machine off, within an hour, they called in one of the most famous pathologists in the country to do a post-mortem. His verdict was that her nervous system and her muscle system had the appearance of a person who had been dead for at least a week. And the question, was she dead or was she not dead? Now, this arose acutely in Sweden. In Sweden, they brought a comparatively young woman into hospital in her early 40s. She was suffering from a cerebral hemorrhage, and she was unconscious. Well, she was alive in a sense that more she wasn't getting artificial respiration or anything. She was alive in a real sense of the term. But they wanted her kidney. Of course, she couldn't give any permission because she was completely unconscious, but her husband gave permission. And they took her kidney out, and they transplanted it, and they put her in a respirating machine, and she died in 2 days. What about that? See, this woman wasn't really dead. You couldn't do that in this country. This woman wasn't really dead. The third case, also taken from the book, came from England. And in England, there was a man who was knocked down in a fight, and the back of whose head was so smashed up that he had irreversible brain damage. Now, he was brought in, and it was obvious there was no recovery for him, but they needed a kidney. So they put him on a respirating machine with his relative's consent. He couldn't give his own, of course. They put him on a machine, and they kept him alive for a couple of days. Then there came the time to transplant his kidney. They took his kidney out, and they switched off. Now, just what do you make of this kind of thing? You see, I've actually heard surgeons talk about keeping a bank of bodies. That if you part them up like spare parts for a motor car or something like that. There is something a little frightening about this. There is no sense of the dignity of manhood, of humanity. And also there is this, one of my surgeon friends, who is against this largely, says that he personally demands the right to die. This is precisely what you don't get. You could be kept alive for any length of time by machines. And you see, it's so difficult to decide what life is. The professor of biology in Oxford, some time ago, bought a piece of meat in a butcher's shop. He took the meat home, and he took cells from the muscular tissue of the beef. And he cultured these cells in cultural tissue, and the cells grew. In other words, the meat was alive. A slab of meat was alive. It had life in it when it was in the butcher's shop window. These are extraordinary thoughts. And these thoughts have not yet been solved. And I don't know what the majority of medical opinion would say, but there's a strong medical opinion that always you should think of the welfare of the patient, not of the welfare of some hypothetical character who is going to get his kidney. Now, the responsibility in the first instance is to the person who is ill and whom you're going to make the donor of the kidney. In other words, I think we've got to say about this whole question of organ transplant that it has certainly got immense possibilities, but we must still look at it, as most surgeons do, with very grave reservations.